Electric vehicles are becoming more and more popular on the street and even in motorsport now. I'm here with Joel from Scalar to talk about their 500 horsepower electric converted GR86. So Joel, we're standing here with what's a pretty recent car, but with some big changes made. Can you just give us a rundown of what the starting platform is here?
Yeah, so we started with a 2022 Toyota GR86. Basically brought it to the shop. We stripped it down to just its bare shell and suspension and then converted it to an EV platform.
Right, yeah, so pretty low mileage when you started?
It had 25 kilometers on it when we bought it and 106 by the time we got to the shop. So yeah, it's brand new.
Right, so getting straight into it. The EV conversion, can you talk us through the basic components, the battery pack, the electric motor that's being used?
Yeah, so basically we have a 65 kilowatt hour battery. It's in a T-shape, sits in the back seat where the fuel cell is and runs up the transmission tunnel and terminates in the front engine bay. The motor is a stealth EV motor with a BorgWarner custom core. It's capable of doing 500 horsepower, but right now because of the series that we're running it in, we have it tuned to 330 horsepower and 350 foot-pounds of torque. Runs a Cascadia inverter, gear reduction box. It's got a 5-to-1 gear reduction box that retains the factory differential carrier from the GR86 diff. So that means that this gear reduction box will be able to use the GR86 axles, so it retains all of the factory GR86 stuff to make it user-friendly for end users.
So the entire suspension from the diff out is basically factory stuff, or allows you to use off-the-shelf aftermarket parts just like you would with any GR86 build.
Yeah, our big thing with this car is we wanted to retain the wonderful setup that this car is. That's the reason why we chose it. It's a wonderful driving car, whether it's time attack, drift, any racing series. It's so well balanced. The aftermarket support is amazing for it. So our gearbox drops down through the center of the subframe, retains all of the suspension geometry to make it a really wonderful driving car.
And you mentioned that you are using the factory diff inside that transmission unit. So you can just use any LSD basically that would be offered for that diff anyway?
Yeah, exactly. That was another aspect too. If you wanted to upgrade to a 1.5 or a 2-way, you know, Cusco or a Tome, you can just unbolt our gear housing, bolt in the upgraded diff, and it accepts it for a GR86.
Right, so just backing up a little bit to the battery system in it, you mentioned it's in a T-shape, kind of going through the transmission tunnel to the back of the car and then separating where the factory fuel tank would be behind the driver's seat. Why do that rather than the typical skateboard kind of platform under the car?
So a big reason for that is we wanted to be able to keep the car low to the ground. If you look at any other EV cars, they're really tall, they're really big. We wanted to keep the car small, low to the ground. Drivers, also lots of headroom. I'm a tall person, so we wanted to keep it very ergonomic for users as well, and just a familiar platform to sit in.
Right, so talking about that, the seating position, this car's obviously fully caged, intended for a race series. What type of racing is this going to be doing? What class would it fit in?
So it's going to fit in the NASA ST2 Series is what we're targeting with the power to weight. We really wanted this car to be the first EV car that you can go wheel-to-wheel racing with not only another, you know, combustion car, but also other EV cars. So that was a really, really big proponent for us in how we built this car.
So that race series, it's based on power to rate, obviously, rather than capacity, because there's no engine capacity.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's a power to weight class. You take the weight of the car, which is only 3,000 pounds. The factory car came out weighing 2,800 pounds off the showroom floor. So another aspect we wanted to keep in check was the weight. We wanted it to be really close to the balance. Right now, it's a 45% front, 55% rear. So it's targeting like a mid-engine sports car.
And you mentioned 330 horsepower. Wheel horsepower, is it?
Yep, 330 horsepower and then 350 foot-pounds of torque.
So a significant bump up from the factory of this. Is that balance of power to weight something that you'd like to improve in the future or to run up into another class, or how does that work?
So as far as like increasing the power on my own one that I build, I'm definitely going to make it the 500 horsepower. We will give it the option to the end user to have an upgraded option most likely. But for right now, we want to run our own spec series for this car. So we want to have you buy this car and then be able to take it, race against other EV cars. Now you're running the exact same car. And that really comes down to be a lot of fun about the driver. Spec series are super popular here in North America. So we really also wanted to target that.
So yeah, you're planning on producing a number of these cars, obviously, not just this one. Can you talk us through that process?
Yeah, so the first thing we're going to do is make 10 production cars, or it's like founder cars, over the 2023 season. We'll develop the car with you after we've taken this car, done our own tuning. The first 10 cars will be our founder cars. At the end of the season, anything that we need to replace to be a production car, we'll upgrade you for free, whether it's an updated battery design, an updated inverter, any parts that we find are susceptible to failure, you'll get a free upgrade. And then after that, we're going to make 50 of them a year.
Right, talking about that running costs, I guess, things failing and stuff. There's obviously a lot of that with vehicles being developed for the first time. In terms of the running costs of running this car compared to if we were running the factory boxer engine, potentially with force induction to make the similar power, what type of different running costs would you imagine there would be between this and that?
So the running costs of the EV are super cheap compared to an ICE car. Not only the unreliability of a boxer engine, we all know about that, but the motor, you need to replace the bearings every 1,000 hours, maybe replace the oil in the dry sump system every year. The battery pack, we expect you to get 4 to 5 years out of it. So where an ICE car, you would end up doing a motor replace or like motor rebuild or a refresh maybe at the end of your season. You won't need to do anything to this until you need to service the battery pack in about 4 years.
Right. So yeah, that I guess is going to be significantly cheaper. There still is a cost associated with that, and then of course with maintenance with the rest of the car, your tires, your brake pads, things like that.
Yeah, standard other stuff. Also with the regen and the motor, you'll probably go through less rear brakes because the regen will do a lot of the braking for you in the back. Regen can actually be tuned so that it locks up the rear, like it will lock the rear wheels up if you tune it. We're obviously not going to do that, but that will be a big calculation in our brake bias as well, how much the regen acts to upsetting the car too. So that's all that we're going to do in the tuning over the winter.
So yeah, that regen obviously has effect on the amount of battery life that you have as well. What was the battery life?
So the battery life, so 65 kilowatt hour battery, it's an 800 volt system. It'll run 45 minutes on a charge, and we can expect a 20 minute recharge at level 3.
So the racing series that it's running in is obviously needs to be shorter than that. In the future, is there any plans to hopefully do some type of endurance racing with it?
So my background is some endurance racing. To get this car to be a swappable battery in an endurance, or get it to the point where we can do like a Formula E style recharge in like 30 seconds to get you another runtime. Absolutely. That's the goal with this. We want to be running it in an endurance series.
So just backing up a little bit to, I guess, the design of this vehicle, you mentioned something when we were talking earlier about 3D scanning and then the cage and any CAD design.
Yeah, so the first thing we did with this car is we 3D scanned it. This battery pack is bespoke to this car. We designed it to go around all the structural members of the car, but then also become a structural component to the car. The underside of the battery is completely tied in with a skid plate, a quarter inch aluminum plate that ties the frame rail from the outside to the inside and becomes a member of the car. So everything from the cage, from the battery pack, to the motor, the gearbox, everything was 3D scanned and then constructed around the chassis of the car.
Do you know what CAD program specifically was used to design these things?
So it was a mix of SOLIDWORKS and Fusion. The cage was designed in SOLIDWORKS and the rest of the car has been designed in Fusion 360.
And the cage, is that built to a certain spec?
Yeah, so the cage is an FIA spec. Also from our experience with racing, because endurance race was a target that we would like to go with, we wanted a cage that's easy for you as a driver to get in and out of. So not only does it meet all the FIA spec for the cage requirements, it also has a great ingress egress. The door bars come out into the door, gives you a nice feel as a driver, not claustrophobic, a lot of room to move, especially for people who are taller, multiple different sizes of drivers, because this is going to be sold to the general like race community, so they come in all different sizes.
Yeah, I see this car being well fit for like a spec series kind of thing like that. In terms of the VCU, things like that, being able to control an electric car, does that lend itself more to that type of spec series where the organizer can have more control over the power output, etc.?
Yeah, so that's going to be a big thing we're going to develop in this car, is our own VCU. A number of organizations that we talked to had a number of compliance issues. When you're running a spec series or an ST series where it's a power to weight, we would get them where the cars would be fine on the dyno, and then the second they get out to the track, they're all of a sudden running a different tune. They can't tell. I've been racing where it's a car's in my class, and then we get out to the straightaway, and all of a sudden qualifying, we were fine, and then now on the straightaway racing, and now he's way faster. So it's really frustrating, but with the VCU, we're gonna run security in the VCU. The other founders, their background is all in tech and cybersecurity and cloud service. So they're gonna develop a VCU that will allow you not to cheat. Basically, as a race organizer, you'll be able to look at the VCU be assured that it's not been tampered with. It'll be reporting back all of its data. Not only that, the car will be connected to the cloud. It'll be reporting its acceleration rate. It will know that at this power to weight ratio, it should not be accelerating it more than this, and it'll red flag the organizers. And it just gives a lot of people who are in the community a chance to actually race with, you know, down to the driver, because not only is it frustrating for the organizers, but I've talked to people where it's like, I won't race a certain series because I know that there's cheaters.
You mentioned with that cloud stuff before and the telemetry being able to be used for potentially esports kind of things.
Yeah, so we would like to have everything that this car does every second of its life will be connected to the cloud, video, vehicle data, and telemetry. So we want to take that. So say I'm racing on the weekend, you're on your eSIM at home, and you want to be able to race me while I'm racing live. So obviously I might be able to run you off the track. You can't run me off the track, but like that kind of like integration to bring the community that's not on the track, you know, to the track, because the joke is, you know, in amateur racing, the drivers all know the fans, but in professional racing, the fans all know the drivers. So we want to bring an integration where it not only, because you have small little niche race series where they have struggles getting sponsorship, struggle getting participation. So if we can take the aspect of this car and then globally like expand it out to more than just the drivers and their family, that's also another goal with this car.
Yeah, it's an exciting potential future and direction that all this could go in for sure. Just moving back to the chassis side of things, the vehicle dynamic suspension, I notice there's a booster delete on the car. Can you talk us through what's the reason for doing that?
So with the brake, deleting the brake booster, well, one, we don't have a vacuum source anymore. But two, from my experience, and a very analog car as a driver is what I want. I want to be able to expand my skills and become a better driver without the nannies, without the computers trying to take over. Like with this car, and especially with an EV, all the EV cars nowadays are all nannied up. They won't let you, even if you buy a Tesla Model 3 model, like performance, it's a track. It knows you're at the track. It switches to track mode, but you can't even turn so aggressively into the corner and it starts shutting down. The stability management comes in. We want this to be a driver, like a car that you can learn how to drive without, you know, the computers interrupting everything. Obviously we might have a little bit of a torque management system in, because the power, all that torque at one RPM is a lot to handle. But that'll be very tunable to the driver. If you don't want to have that torque management on, you can turn that off. But we wanted the brake feel to be raw. We wanted you to feel it through the pedal. Everything the wheels are doing, we want you as the driver to feel that. So that was a very big goal for this car.
Yeah, it's interesting because usually when people think EVs, they don't think of a raw driving experience, but it's good to know that that's still a possibility and potentially an upside for people looking to do the conversion. You mentioned being able to tune the torque, obviously. Is that something that could be used for like driver training?
Absolutely. So with this car, well, a very big key part of it was to have a passenger seat. Now, not in a race series, you can't run with passengers. You're only allowed to run just the driver. But for the learning and coaching side of things, to have a coach in this car, have a novice driver, now you're not worrying about shift points, the engine, transmission. It's very tunable to the coach, the power level that the novice driver gets. They can focus on lines, braking zones, and being up close to other cars without having to worry about the engine.
Yeah, cool. And just back to the suspension side of things, this is a fairly new platform. Is there options out there already for coilovers, for example?
So the nice thing that Toyota did with this, and another reason why we chose it, all of the suspension components on this are the same as the Gen 1. It's coilovers, control arms, knuckles, they're all literally the same thing. So to find a partner to develop this, which we're using Olin suspension, we're going to take it to their shaker rig, and they have an 8-axis shaker rig. So once this car gets there, they'll shake it, emulate any kind of track surface and conditions, develop the valving, the spring rates, specifically for this car.
Yeah, that's really interesting. At that point, because you've obviously potentially, well, definitely changed the center of gravity point of this, is that something you're going to be looking at the same time?
Absolutely. We'll get all the data on all the suspension points, the geometry, the center of gravity, the weight balance. Everything will be tuned in by them down there.
Yeah. Cool. And like you said, it's based on the Gen 1 of this, the 86. That means the brakes fit as well. What's the plan there?
Yeah, so right now we have just the Wilwood brakes on it. It's something that we're familiar with. We're working on working with other partners. We're looking at AP Racing, but this is actually a Gen 1 brake kit that we put on this car. Like it fits. So it's not, again, just the compatibility with Gen 1 parts to Gen 2 is just amazing, and especially with the brakes.
Interested, before you said like there's regenerative braking in the rear. How does that affect the brake balance? You know, that's obviously adding braking force to the rear. You, at certain speeds, do you need to kind of tune that brake balance with the hydraulic system?
Yeah, so we have an adjustable brake bias valve in it now. Part of our tuning, because once the battery's at 90 or like 100% charge, you can't regen because you need somewhere to put the energy. So if the battery's already full, you can't use regen. So this is all in the calculations and what we're gonna do, how much battery state of charge that it leaves with so that we can do regen, and the car feels the same from the first lap to the last lap.
Yeah, interesting. I'm just back on the subject of like the cage and safety, electric cars, thermal runaway, electrical fires. What have you done there to kind of for the safety side?
So all of that is very scary, especially for street cars. We've all seen a battery car catches fire and the battery, they can't, like it burns, it's hot, it's violent, burns for a long time. A lot of manufacturers state that you need to dump thousands of gallons of water on it in order to put the fire out. So that's a number of reasons why EVs are not very prevalent on racetracks, and especially wheel to wheel. Most tracks have a policy that you cannot race an EV in their series. So working with NASA and their Super Touring Series, we've taken all the FIA standards for batteries, applied it to this car, and then gone a step above and beyond. We've taken fire suppression, and an industry first, we've plumbed it through the battery pack. We're working with Lifeline for that. The fire bottle on the passenger side, not only when it's detonated, will go to the driver's compartment, but we'll also flood the pack from the back to the front. So that's one thing. We've also got the fire suppressant by HP Fuller. Each cylindrical cell is wrapped by this foam that as the cell runs away, its thermal properties actually get higher. So its R value goes up. So it won't catch other cells on fire and it won't propagate through the pack. So through testing with these packs, cells that have been induced into a runaway don't propagate through the rest of the pack, and it stays a localized event, stays inside the pack, makes it safe for the driver, the track, and the car.
Yeah, saving components, a lot of money, and of course the driver. Yeah, thank you for your time. It's been a really interesting talk. If anyone wants to find out more about what you guys do, about the product, potentially buying one of these vehicles, where should they go?
So scalarperformance.com is our website. You can follow us on all the socials as well. We're on Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube. Stay tuned to all that. In May of next year, we're actually going to be having a press day where we're going to have people come out. We're going to have a gas version and electric version at Atlanta Motorsports Park, and we're going to encourage everyone to come out who wants to buy one, who's applied to buy one. We're taking applications until January this year for you to be one of the first 10 buyers. But come out and drive the car and see what it feels to drive an electric race car.
Awesome. Well, thank you for your time, and we look forward to seeing how it all works out for you.
Awesome.
Good luck. Cheers.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.